friends, I am Krishna Kanjani from LG Institute of Engineering and Technology. Welcome to the online lecture series on kinematics and theory of machine. In today's session, we will learn our chapter number 6, that is friction, clutch and brake. In today's session, we will discuss about the brake component. Okay, so let's start the session with the introduction of brakes. Now, from this diagram, we can understand that brakes are the elements which are mainly used to stop or retard, or we can say reduce the motion of any moving body. In this front view, you can observe that the element which is a wheel is rotating. Now this rotation of wheel is stopped with the help of this brake arrangement. Now over here in this side view, you can understand the mechanism that due to external force application over here, due to the pressure which is applied on this hydraulic, or we can say this fluid, this stationary component which is applying a resisting force on this rotating body, and due to which the rotation of this body is stopped, or we can say at certain level we can also reduce the speed of this element. Okay, so in this way we can simply define that a brake is a device by means of which we are producing an artificial frictional resistance over here, and due to this artificial frictional resistance, a body which is moving is stopped, or we can say at certain level we can also reduce, or we can retard the speed of that motion of that body. Okay, now how this motion is stopped? So over here we are applying some external force. Now due to this external force, this moving body is stopped. Now this moving body is possessing some kind of kinetic energy. Now this kinetic energy will be absorbed by this brake material. Now due to absorption of this kinetic energy, this material may be at certain level it will be damaged. So the material should possess a quality in which it will directly dissipate this heat into either air or in the water which is surrounding around the passage of the brake drum. Okay, so in this way we can simply learn that in case of brake, we are simply converting this kinetic energy, and this converted kinetic energy is absorbed, or we can say is dissipated either in the air or in the water which is circulating through this brake drum. So now let's understand the qualities, or we can say the properties which must be required by these brake linings. Okay, so the first quality which is required is the low wear rate. What it means that when it is in contact with this rotating element, there will be some kind of wear, or we can say the particle from the surface of this contact will be removed. So this wear rate must be very low, otherwise what will happen that after certain use of this friction linings, it will be worn out. So in that case we have to replace. Over here we have to understand one thing, that the strength of this brake or brake material must be very low compared to your rotating element, or which is known as a drum of this wheel, because otherwise what will happen, due to high strength of this friction linings over here, it may be possible that your wheel will be worn out. Okay, so be careful over here. The strength of this friction lining should be very less compared to your rotating element, that is wheel. Okay, now second property, that is high heat resistance. What it means, the heat which is developed due to absorption of this kinetic energy must be very easily dissipated into air or in the water. The third property, that is high heat dissipation capacity. What it means, the amount of heat which is dissipated in the air, or we can say in the water, must be in a very high amount. Okay, then the next one, that is it should be not affected by the moisture or oil, because the brakes are mainly used in a vehicles. Now these vehicles will be running in a various conditions, so now these various atmospheric conditions should not affect the working of this brake system. Okay, and the last and the most important property, that the high coefficient of friction. Okay, the coefficient of friction must be very high. So we can simply say that it must possess a very high resisting capacity. So it will produce the high resistance between this rotating body and this fixed body. Okay, so in this way we can produce high amount of friction, and this will help you to develop high amount of braking force. Okay, so these are the basic material properties which are required for this brake material. The types or classification of brakes. Okay, so these brakes are mainly classified into three categories, that is hydraulic brakes, electrical brakes and mechanical brakes. Now, as the name indicates, the hydraulic brakes, in which if we are using a fluid, either a water or any liquid which is helping us to produce the external force, then it is known as a hydraulic brakes. If we are using electric brakes, so in that case we will be using an electrical elements. Okay, now these both the brakes are producing a very high amount of forces. Okay, so where we are using a very heavy duty trucks or in a systems where we require high amount of force, then in that case we will be using these hydraulic and electrical brakes. And the third type of brake, which is known as a mechanical brakes. Now these mechanical brakes are also classified into two categories, that is according to the direction of force which is acting on this body, either it is acting in a radial direction or in a axial direction. Okay, now these radial direction brakes we will study in our syllabus. Now these radial brakes are also classified into two categories, that is internal brakes and external brakes, and that is also divided into subcategories like is a single shoe brake, or we can say the band brakes. Okay, so in our syllabus we will study the single shoe brake and band brakes. Okay, so let's start with the first type, that is single shoe brake. Okay, now first we have to understand this diagram. Now this diagram possessing first one fixation point, which is known as a fulcrum point, O point. Now about this O point, this whole lever is moving, or we can say it is able to oscillate. Now due to external force which is applied on this lever, the lever will be moving in a downward direction, and due to downward direction motion, over here we are enabling this system with one single shoe. Okay, so this shoe type of arrangement, or we can say this friction lining material, this block will be in contact with this rotating element. Okay, now due to the contact between this rotating element, which is rotating in anti-clockwise direction, the contact surface over here, this will produce a frictional resistance, and this frictional resistance will help us to reduce the speed, or we can say to stop this rotating body. Okay, now over here we have to learn three fundamental forces which are acting on this body. So the first fundamental force, which is known as a external force P. Now this external force P is applied at the end of this lever. Now over here you can observe that due to this external force P, this lever will be moving in a downward direction. Now the second fundamental force which is acting on this system is this reaction force Rn. Over here you can observe that due to this reaction force Rn, now this reaction force is developed due to this frictional force which is acting between the contact surface of two bodies. And the third force, that is this frictional resistance force, or we can say the force which is transmitted at the tangential contact surface. After learning these fundamental forces, over here we have to consider three different positions of this fulcrum point. Over here you can refer that if we consider this fulcrum point at the center point, or we can say this frictional force which is passing through the center of this fulcrum point, that is the first condition. The second condition in which we will consider that this fulcrum point is below the frictional resistance lining, and the third condition where it is above the frictional force lining. Okay, so by referring these three different cases, we can derive three equations for this single shoe brakes. Okay, so let's start derivation of this single shoe brakes. Okay, so the first case in which we will consider that our fulcrum point is at the center, and our frictional force which is passing from this axis of this fulcrum point. Okay, so let's consider the first case where the body is moving in a clockwise direction. Now over here you have to refer the direction of this frictional force, which is very important. Now you can refer that this body or this drum, or we can say this wheel, is rotating in a clockwise direction. Now due to rotation of this body in a clockwise direction, frictional forces which is developed in this rotating body, that is wheel, will be in a clockwise direction, which is opposite to this. Okay, now similarly the other motion which is developed between this shoe. Now this shoe will be facing in a opposite direction of motion. So we can consider that as the wheel is rotating in a clockwise direction, we can assume that this shoe is rotating in an anti-clockwise direction. Now due to anti-clockwise rotation of this shoe, we can consider the frictional force which is developed at the contact surface in this shoe will be in this direction. Okay, so in this way we can identify that the frictional direction, frictional force which is acting will be in this direction. Now to derive the equation, we have to consider the component of forces. So the first component, that is P, external force which is applied at the end of the lever. The second one, that is the reaction force which is acting on a contact surface of this shoe and this rotating body. R is the radius of your wheel. Then 2 theta, that is the angle of lap. Okay, so over here we can consider that the shoe will be in contact with this 2 theta angle. So now this 2 theta is the angle of contact of surface of this block. Okay, and this Ft is known as a frictional force, or we can say again that the braking force which is applied at the tangential direction of this contact surface. Okay, now to stop this vehicle we have to develop tangential torque. Okay, so this tangential torque which is developed, now to calculate this torque we have a simple relation, that torque is equal to force into radius. So first we have to derive the equation of frictional force. So now tangential braking force which is applied, that is Fr, or we can say Ft. Now a simple equation for frictional force, F is equal to mu into Rn. Okay, now this equation we have learned in our topic of friction. Okay, so we can simply understand that frictional force Ft is equal to mu into Rn. Now the frictional braking torque will be a torque is equal to force into radius. So over there we can put the equation of Ft, so it will be mu Rn into radius R. Okay, so now we have to find out the value of this normal reaction force due to this frictional force. Okay, so now to develop this equation of Rn, we have to take moment about this O point, which is a fulcrum point. So let's take moment about this fulcrum point, that is O point. Over here we have to refer that in this body there will be three type of forces, P, Ft and Rn. Now first let's consider this Ft force. Now this direction of this Ft force is passing from the O point, so it will not produce any effect on this body in terms of moment. Okay, over here if you have to calculate the moment, then we have a simple equation, that is force into perpendicular distance. But now over here the force is passing from the axis of O, so the distance will be zero. So that's why the effect of this Ft will be zero in terms of moment. Okay, so now we have to take moment according to the P force and Rn force. Okay, so now about point O, if you consider the P force, so now the P force will produce the effect of moment, that is P into perpendicular distance L. So here the equation will be P into L, which is in a clockwise direction. Now similarly the effect of Rn, now this Rn force is acting in a vertical direction, so it will try to rotate this body in a anti-clockwise direction. So we can consider that Rn into the distance, which is x. Okay, so your equation will be Rn into x is equal to P into L, because this Rn into x will be rotating in an anti-clockwise direction and this PL moment will be acting in a clockwise direction. Okay, so from this we can simplify that Rn is equal to P into L by x. Now we can put this equation of Rn into our equation of torque. So we can derive the simple equation, that is mu PL by x into R. So now by simplifying this equation, we can simply derive that the torque which is developed due to the friction between this shoe and this rotating wheel, the final equation, that is torque is equal to mu PLR divided by x. Over here in this diagram we have referred that this wheel is rotating in a clockwise direction only, but if we are assuming that this wheel is rotating in a anti-clockwise direction, okay, so now in that case what will happen? So now your direction of this Ft will be changing. You can refer over here that if the wheel is rotating in an anti-clockwise direction, so the frictional force in this wheel will be in a positive x direction. So similarly your frictional force in the shoe will be in a negative x direction. Okay, so in this way we can find out the effect of FT. But in our previous derivation, we have learned that FT is not producing any moment. Okay, so over here in this equation of moment, there won't be any change. Okay, so your final equation, if we start the procedure, then again your FT and TB will be the same. Now you have to derive the take the moment about point O. So again your component of FT is not acting. So again your frictional force FT is not producing any effect. So that's why P into L, that is producing in a clockwise direction rotation, and this Rn is producing in a anti-clockwise direction rotation. Okay, so your final equation, that is equal to Rn into X is equal to P into L. So in this way, the condition for clockwise and anti-clockwise direction rotation of this wheel will be same if we are assuming that this FT is passing from the fulcrum point O. Okay, now let's consider the second case in which we have to assume that this body which is placed slightly below and your fulcrum point, that is O point, is slightly above the frictional resistance. Over here in this diagram you can refer that FT and this fulcrum point possessing a simple distance A. Okay, so now in this case we have to again derive the equation. So now there will be only change in the moment about point O. Okay, so rest of the all the equations that we have derived in our previous terms, that is the equation of, over here you can refer, the equation of torque will be same in any of the case. Okay, so now if you consider this TB is equal to FT into R, so again we have to calculate the Rn component. So now in case 2, there will be change in moment component only. Okay, so similarly let's derive the moment about point O. So in this case, if we take moment about point O, so now we have to calculate that for the first P force. Now due to this P force, which is acting in a downward direction, so your moment will be in a clockwise direction. So we can consider P into L in clockwise direction. Now second one, that is this FT force. Now due to this FT force about this fulcrum point O, so you can refer that this FT point is acting in a negative X direction. So if you refer negative X direction from this point, so over here we can refer that it will be try to rotating in a anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so we have a simple relation that this FT will be try to moving in a anti-clockwise direction. So FT into A, that will be in an anti-clockwise direction, and P into L, that will be in a clockwise direction. So that's why they both will lie on a different side of this equal to. Now the third component, that is Rn. Now this Rn force is always acting in a upward direction. Now this upward direction motion will again try to rotate in a anti-clockwise direction. So that is also in a similar of your FT force. So it will be also lie in a same side of your FT moment. Okay, so over here you can derive that Rn into X plus FT into A is equal to PL. Okay, now by simplifying this equation, we can derive the equation, we can derive the value for Rn. So now to simplify this equation, that is frictional force FT, so we can put frictional force F is equal to mu into Rn. So your equation will be mu Rn into A. So now you have to take common Rn from these two terms. So your equation will be Rn is equal to PL divided by X plus mu into A. Okay, now you can put this equation of this reaction force into your breaking torque equation, that is TB is equal to mu Rn into R. So over here you will get the final equation, that is mu PLR upon X plus mu. That is the condition when the body or the wheel is rotating in a clockwise direction. Now let's consider that this body is moving in a anti-clockwise direction. So now what will happen? So due to the change in direction, the only change that will happen over here will be this frictional force, that is FT, will be acting in a negative X direction. Over here it was acting in a positive X direction. Okay, so now you can derive the equation for moment about point O. So now what will happen? So now this FT force, which is acting in this negative X direction, will try to rotate in a clockwise direction. Again your P force, which is producing in a again clockwise rotation. So that's why over here we have to simple understand that PL plus FT into A, that both will be lying in a clockwise direction, and your Rn, this reaction force, will try to produce in a anti-clockwise direction. So that's why Rn into X is equal to PL plus FT into A. Now, again by replacing this Ft force by mu Rn, we will get the final equation of Pl plus mu Rn into A. Now, in this term, again we have to put this mu Rn into A term over this side. So, we can simply write down that the final equation will be your, in which we are taking this Rn as a common term. So, we can simply write down that your Rn will be common out. So, your x minus mu into A. Okay, so x minus mu into A is equal to Pl. So your Rn equation will be Pl upon x minus mu A. Okay, so the only change that will happen over here, that is the x plus mu A, that was in a clockwise direction, while over here x minus mu A in an anticlockwise direction. So in this way you can derive the final equation of torque Tb, that is equal to mu Rn into small r, where by replacing this Rn term with Pl upon x minus mu A, you will get the final equation of torque when the wheel is rotating in an anti-clockwise direction. Okay, your frictional force which is developed is slightly above the fulcrum point O. Okay, so it is slightly above side. So now your the equation when it is considered in a clockwise direction rotation. Okay, so let's consider that wheel is rotating in a clockwise direction. So due to that, the frictional force is acting in a plus x direction. Okay, so over there, by taking moment about this fulcrum point O, you can simply derive that your P force and the moment, that is P into L, will be in a clockwise direction. Now, second force, that is this Ft force. Now, due to this Ft force which is moving in a plus x direction, so about O point, it will be also moving in a clockwise direction. And the Rn force will be acting in an upward direction, so it will produce motion about fulcrum point O in a anti-clockwise direction. So we can simply understand that two components, that is P into L plus Ft into A, they both will be in a clockwise direction, and your reaction force Rn will be in a anti-clockwise direction. So that's why your final equation will become Rn into X is equal to Pl plus Ft into A. Again, you are replacing this frictional force Ft with mu Rn. So you can simply derive the equation of Rn, that is equal to Pl by x minus mu A. Now, by putting this reaction force in our frictional torque, or we can say the braking torque which is applied between these two bodies, will be simple. Tb is equal to mu Rn into R. While we are putting the value of reaction force over here, we can derive the final equation of torque. Okay, now let's consider the last segment, that is the anti-clockwise rotation of brake when the frictional force Ft, which is acting slightly above of the fulcrum point O. Okay, so now only change that it is rotating in a anti-clockwise direction, so your Ft will be acting in a minus x direction. So now due to minus x direction of Ft, this Ft will produce the rotation about anti-clockwise direction. Similarly, your Rn will be producing rotation about anti-clockwise direction, and your P force will be producing rotation about clockwise direction. So by taking moment about fulcrum point O, we can simplify that Rn into X, that is in anticlockwise, plus Ft into A, again in anticlockwise, is equal to P into L, that is in a clockwise direction. So by again simplifying, we can derive the equation of Rn, that is equal to Pl by X plus mu A. And by putting this reaction force in our equation of braking torque, we can derive the final equation Tb is equal to mu Rn into R, which is equal to mu PLR upon X plus mu A. Now by referring these two equations, you can simply understand that in case of case number 3, these two equations are simply interchanged as we have derived in case of case 2. Okay, thank you.